Students, today we are going to discuss about Bainitic transformations in STLs. I have introduced you in the last class and we are going to discuss in detail. As I told you that in STLs, austenite is the high temperature FCC solution of carbon in iron. And there are three different pathways of transforming austenite. One is the classical way of forming perlite from austenite just by cooling below the U1 temperature. Second one is the rapid quenching of steel from austenitic state to martensite. And third one, the most classical one I would say, is quenching the steel from the austenitic state to an intermediate temperature of something like 300 to 400 degrees Celsius temperature and keeping there for a long time will lead to formation of bainite. As you know, bainite, the name came from the scientist called E.C. Brain or Edgar Brain, who discovered the way or mechanisms of martensitic transformations. So therefore, in all the slides, as you see here, bainitic transformation which forms from austenite, I have written the mechanism as a sign of interrogation. The reason is that it is not yet fully understood what actually happens. But let me just tell you briefly what actually happens. You know, bainitic transformations is the product of bainitic transformation is again ferrite and cementite. But the morphologies are different, which we will discuss again in some slides. Morphologies are different. In perlite also we have ferrite and cementite, but perlite forms as a lamellar morphology in which the growth is dominated by the carbon diffusion in the from the perlite to the product phase to the parent phase across the interface between these two. And it leads to formation of lamellar morphology, which can be easily explained, as I have done in the class few lectures back. Martensites is diffusionless transformations, but in a bainite you form the same component of like ferrite and cementite as the microstructural pieces. The formation is different. In fact, bainite forms in the temperature range which is intermediate between perlite and the martensite. You know, perlite transformations stops to happen at about 400 degrees Celsius temperature. That what does it mean? That perlite transformation starts at A1 temperature, but it will, you know, as the temperature goes down, as the diffusion of iron and carbon will be very, very slow at lower temperatures. So therefore, the transformation actually is almost stop at about 400 degrees Celsius temperature. So as the temperature decreases, the carbon diffusion is slower in the austenitic phase, the metastable austenitic phase below A1 temperature, and because of that, perlite transformations become very slow, the interlamellar spacings become very small. And as the interlamellar spacing becomes small, the interfacial area between the ferrite and the cementite will be very large, and system needs to provide that energy, you know. And therefore, it's very difficult to, you know, have the transformation at a low temperature when fixed diving force is available. So, at about 400 Celsius temperature, the perlite transformation compete or bainite transformation compete with the perlite transformation. All the products are same. So this is the upper end of temperature at which the bainitic transformation can happen nicely. It will not, the perlite transformation will not interfere the bainitic transformation. On the other hand, at the lower temperature, you know, martensites forms below MS temperature as I discussed within the class. So at lower temperature, normally 100 degrees above the MS is what is the lowest temperature of bainitic transformations. So it is some sort of like 400 to 250 degrees Celsius temperature for most of the steels in which the bainite transformation happens. Now, very funny to understand that, you know, as the temperature decreases, as you decrease the temperature, the diffusivity of both carbon and the iron will be decreased. That's very simple to understand. Diffusivity is given by this equation. D stands for diffusivity equal to D0. Into exponential minus qy at t, where d0 is a p exponential term which is a constant term. Q is the activation energy and r is the universal gas constant and t is the temperature. with this equation clearly tells you that as the temperature decreases, diffusivity will decrease. So at very low temperature, like 350, 400 degrees Celsius temperature, or even, you know, diffusivity of carbon may be significant, but iron will not move at all, because iron diffusivity will be very low at 400 degrees Celsius temperature. That's because iron melting temperature is very high, about 1439 degrees Celsius temperature, and iron iron atom sits in the lattice positions, unlike carbon atoms which sits in the interstitial positions. So therefore, to move the iron atom, even for short range change of the ordering, is very difficult at about 400 degrees Celsius temperature. So in Bainite transformations, carbon atoms, diffusion of carbon atom do happen from one interstitial position to other interstitial positions, but iron atom do not diffuse at all. So only way iron atoms can change is position, okay, from in austenite to the ferrite plus cementite mixture is by the cooperative movement, as happens in case of martensites. In martensites, normally shear forces moves the iron atom from one atomic configuration to other atomic configurations when austenite transform to BCT martensites. But here in this case, in austenite, same thing happens for iron atoms, okay. Iron atoms undergo this shear induced movement because of the transformations. But carbon atoms can diffuse, carbon atoms can undergo, you know, classical diffusion because of the smaller size of atom, and it moves from one interstitial species to other interstitial species. So that's not a problem. So in comparison to the classical Pauli transformations, here the diffusion of both iron and carbon atom are not happening in the same way, or movement of the carbon atom and iron atom are not happening in the same way. Carbon atoms are able to diffuse, although a slower rate, but iron atoms are not at all. In comparison to Martensite transformation, where both carbon and iron atoms basically move because of the application of a shear force in a cooperative manner, in Bainite transformations, both the atoms are not undergoing changes from position due to this shear force, but only iron atom is undergoing. That's why Bainite transformation is very, very complex, and it cannot be explained only like a diffusional transformations or a shear induced transformation like martensites. So that's why I always put sign of interrogation in the Bainite transformations. There are lot of theories available to make it a diffusional transformations partially or a partially shear induced diffusional transformations, but none of these are 100% correct. It can be true for particular steel or particular composition of steel, but in general it is not happening. So that is why Bainite transformation is little bit complex. So at about 400 degrees Celsius temperature, carbon can diffuse significantly, but iron cannot diffuse at all. And 400 is the upper temperature for Bainite transformations. This is the, T U up for Bainite transformation. Okay, and on the other hand, 250 is basically the lower bound of Bainite transformations. So T lower Bainite normally. So as you can see, at lower temperatures, iron cannot diffuse at all, or even short range order transformation. Short range order means small change of the structural order is not possible. Iron cannot do that also. So only way we can move the atoms from austenite to the mixture of ferrite and cementite is by the military movement, which by that application of forces. On the other hand, carbon can diffuse, although at higher temperatures it can diffuse significantly, lower temperature it cannot diffuse. So that's why this whole transformation mechanism for Bainite transformation is still not understood fully. I can make this statement. Okay. And how this transformation actually happens? So that's the important thing you have to look at it. As I told you, there are two types of bainites. The bainite which forms at a high temperature is called upper bainite. A bainite which forms at a lower temperature is called lower bainite. In case of, so this is what is called as lower bainite, and this is what is known as upper bainite. That's what I wrote up and low. So what is the structural difference between these two? In case of upper bainite, it's a plate-like morphology, and in case of lower bainite, it's basically a sheath-like morphology. Let us first discuss the lower bainite. What actually happens when the transformation happens at lower temperatures? That you know, austenite gamma, it transforms to alpha, supersaturated. So as you cool down, so austenite is 950 degree Celsius temperature. So if you cool down this to about 250 degree Celsius, austenite, which can accommodate a lot of carbon, will transform into supersaturated alpha. Okay, and this alpha will come like a Woodman-Staten plates, or Woodman-Staten like, or sheath like morphology, I would say. And these are supersaturated alpha, okay, supersaturated alpha. Supersaturated in terms of carbon. Obviously, alpha cannot take that much of carbon. You know, BCC iron cannot take more than, you know, 0.02% of carbon at about A1 temperatures. So this whatever carbon will be remained is supersaturated. Now at lower temperature, this carbon then precipitate as a ferrite. This carbon is a cementite, so these are all cementite. Okay, that's what happens, and it is easy to understand. This is what happens for lower bainite. Now upper bainite, this case is little bit different. As I told you in the class, that upper bainite will be having gamma 950 degree Celsius temperature, and this will transform into all this alpha. This is alpha, let me write down, supersaturated alpha, obviously. So alpha, and alpha will, lot of supersaturated alpha will form plates like, and then in between this alpha plates, the cementites, let us put it this way. Okay, so these are actually cementite plates. So these are actually F3C will precipitate in between the plates. Sorry, in between means between the space between the two alpha plates. Here, what happens? The cementite is precipitated within the supersaturated alpha sheath. Okay, this is a sheath, supersaturated alpha sheath. You can call just like a leaf, tea leaf. But here, the case is different. Here, you have cementite forming in between the two alpha plates. This is the alpha plates. So that's the difference. Actually, this is, if you cool it down to about, this is lower, this is upper. Okay, this is cooling down to 400 degrees Celsius temperature. That's what will happen. So this is the two morphologies normally observed in the Bainite transformations. Now you know, if I play the chemistry of the alloy, chemistry of the steel, and also play the pulsing condition, I can make these plates nanometer thick. Instead of micrometer thick, I can make them nanometer thick. So as you can make this a nanometer thick, the strength will be very high, ductility also be very high. That's what Professor Harry Badisia from Cambridge has done. And in fact, he has researched so much so that bainite is now, it's an industrial product. Bainite actually is produced by POSCO steel plants in Korea as an industrial product. And this has a much higher strength than the classical perlite. Very fine scale perlite cannot match even the strength of bainites. So depending on your use, one can actually change these morphologies. So you know, that's what the picture says, show you. This picture is showing that this is alpha sheath in which the cementite is precipitated. Okay, so and I have discussed with you about this. Okay, and this is the picture I showed you just few minutes back. You see here, this is a lid, this is basically a sheath, okay, and in which the cementite has precipitated, and both sides you have austenite. This is also austenite, this is also austenite, and this is alpha, and inside are the carbides, mostly they are cementite. Okay, that's what you see here in this picture. On the other hand, you know, here you see here, these are the alpha plates, which has happened for upper bainites, okay, this is a lower. You see alpha plates, and in between the alpha plates, this is actually windmill statin plates, obvious. As I discussed with you class, what happens when gamma transform to alpha? It can happen this way. It can gamma transform to alpha, it can happen this type of plates. These are called windmill statin plates. Okay. As you see here, so this is suppose gamma, this is also gamma. These are the windmill statin alpha plates. So this windmill statin alpha plates, in between the alpha plates, the cementite can precipitate. This is what is shown in this picture. This is a cementite precipitated. Okay, basically idea is to take out the extra carbon out of alpha. So you can either do it by precipitating inside the alpha sheaves, alpha leaves, a leaf, or you can do it in between. That's your, that is the choice of the system. And depending on that, you create two different type of microstructures. You may be thinking which one will have better properties. Obviously, the one in which the cementite precipitates in between will not have good properties. Why? Because cementite is a brittle phase. And as you know, if the brittle phase remains within the plates, between the plates, then what will happen? This will lead to crack formations and it will create problems of brittleness. But on the other hand, the cementite precipitates within these sheaves. This is a precipitation hardenable system in which the strength will be very high, ductility also will be very high. That is the idea. Okay, and that's what I have taken this picture, I told you from Professor Badisia's homepage. You can look at it. It gives you a very vivid descriptions of Bainite transformations and how Bainites form. It is very nicely described. Okay, and this is what is the actual thing I showed you. These are the this is the alpha sheath and in which cementite has precipitated out inside it. And this is the lower Bainites, this is higher upper Bainites. Okay, you can see the cementite has precipitates in between the plates. Well, so I already discussed with you stages of formation of upper Bainite, lower Bainite. Let me again reiterate it. There is nothing wrong in telling you the things again and again. For the lower Bainites, as I told you, initially this is gamma. So alpha formed coherently as a plate or as a sheet rather, it's not a plate sheet. And it's a supersaturated alpha, as I done on the board. And in between the supersaturated alpha, then cementite precipitates. You can see different cementite precipitates. So finally, you have a colony of this alpha sheets. Inside each of these alpha sheets, you have cementite precipitate out. Very nicely observed in the microstructures also. On the other hand, case of upper Bainite, what normally happens is very simple like this. You have a ferrite nuclei forms and ferrite grows, rejecting little bit of carbon. When the ferrite goes inside a austenite, it rejects carbon, right? Ferrite is very lean of carbon. And these carbides, this carbon then form, react with the carbon and forms the carbides. Okay, here you can see these are the carbides, correct? These are a lot of carbides forms. And then actually, these carbides can actually form this in between the plates. Okay, this is this happens when you mix structure is possible, but this normally doesn't happen. So that's how actually both the phases of upper and lower Bainite forms. You know, that's what is shown here. You see here the picture. This is taken from the book. You see this is the Bainite which forms about 350 degrees Celsius temperature. It's upper Bainite. This is the Bainite which forms 278 degrees Celsius temperature, lower Bainite. The morphologies are distinctly different. Okay, so it's basically nucleation and growth phenomena. Transformation again same. Okay, alpha plus Fe3C. And it leads to relief effect. You know, what you see in martensites. Martensites, you know, I don't know whether you have, I have talked about it, but Martensite transformation leads to surface relief. Surface will have relief because of transformations, that's because of the strain. This is also observed in Bainite transformation. That's why Bainite transformation is more complex. It has both the signatures of pyrolytic transformation and the Martensite transformations. Low temperature carbide, there are observations. The low temperature carbide can be epsilon carbide, which I have discussed for the tempering of martensites. And it can have about little less carbon, a little more carbon, 8.4% carbon. Bainite plates have irrational habit planes. Let us not discuss about it. Ferrite and Bainite plates possess different relationship related to the parent phase. And this is taken from the book of Donald Clark and Barney. This reference is given here. Okay, now I want to also tell you something. Distinctly different. You know, sometimes if you are looking at a sample under optical microscopes, you may mistake a Bainite. Like a martensite. That's what is shown here. This is a martensite, you see. and this is the bainite. Difference is this, in a martensite there will be a lot of written austenite, and these are the white areas, these are the written austenite quality areas. But in a bainite there is no such written austenite, because bainite is more close to perlite, so that is why there is no written austenite remain. All austenite transform to bainite. But in martensite, because it is completely shear dominated process, lot of stain generated inside the matrix or inside the austenite, and that is why some written austenite is retained. You cannot completely convert into martensites, that is because of the stain involved. Okay, so with this I just wanted to close on the bainite transformations. Now I am going to discuss on TTT diagrams in this class for the whatever time I have, and also the carry over to the next class. So you know, in industry or in the real shop floors, it is very difficult to tell them what is bainite, martensite or perlite. They may understand, but they cannot use this, and it is not possible to see, always go back, prepare a sample, polish it, make a sample for optical microscopy and then observe it and then find it out. So therefore, what people have done is that for each steel composition, there are transformation curves available, and these transformation curves are known as TTT curves, time, temperature, transformations. There are three T. First T is called time, which will be small t, but normally we write capital T. Second T is called transformation, time temperature, sorry, temperature, and last third T is called transformation. There are three. So ideally these are plots, and ideally this will be three dimensional plots, time, temperature, transformations. Transformation will be percentage always, but normally we do not do that because three dimensional plots are difficult to understand. Metallurgists are not good at, in fact, I will not say that, but metallurgists have difficulty in understanding three dimensional plots, which you will see for ternary phase diagrams. You yourself will realize that it is not easy to, you know, visualize a three dimensional diagram and get some important thing out of it. So that is why you know, we use these two dimensional diagrams in which the horizontal axis will be time in logarithmic scale, vertical axis will be temperature in degree Celsius, and transformation will be plotted like a percentage inside the curve. Okay, let me give you how the curve look like. This is what it looks like. This is, you see, horizontal axis is time and vertical axis is temperature, and percent transformation is given like beginning and ending. Beginning will be 1%, ending will be 99%. So let me first go back how these things are done. First let me start, you know, basically any transformation, whether it is a perlite or martensite or bainite, is obviously transformation rate is what is very important. Rate means how fast the transformation process is taking place. Okay, if you know the rate, then if you know the time, you can multiply the rate with the time, you can get amount transformed. That is very simple. Any mathematician or anybody who knows a little bit of mathematics will be able to tell that. Now transformation rates actually depends on two things, obviously nucleation rate and the growth rate, right. So therefore, if I write T as a transformation rate, capital T, or let us write, you know, okay fine, T dot, that is better, okay, that is very nice, T dot, because capital T is always depends on temperature. So that is basically nothing but dxp for beta phase, suppose, by dxt. And that is a function of nucleation rate and the growth rate. Nucleation rate is represented as I, growth rate is represented as x. So the classical Johnson-Mayer equation, which you do not know, but you can look at physical metallurgy book, will tell you for the perlite transformations, the transformation rate or fraction transform beta is nothing but 1 minus exponential pi exponential to the power minus pi I uq t to the 4 by 3, correct. So now, if I now, you know, obviously this depends on temperature, because I and U are temperature dependent. In nucleation depends on temperature, we know that nucleation depends on phi energy depends on temperature, growth also depends on phi energy available, so this also depends on temperature, temperature inbuilt. Now if I plot temperature versus, you know, I, this is, oh sorry, this is the, these things U, I and T dot. Okay, these three things I have plotted as a function of temperature. Temperature is plotted on the particle axis, and these are all horizontal axis, just to make you realize that this is what is possible. Now, as you know, nucleation rate, obviously nucleation rate I have not discussed, but let us understand that nucleation as you can calculate nucleation rate. It depends on number of nuclei available multiplied by some exponential factor, okay, which can be obtained from any physical metallurgy book, or in the next class if I have time I will discuss with you. Okay, now so to make it short, I can tell that, you know, these are all curves looking like a, you know, U-shaped, inverted C-shaped curve, correct. See the temperature, nucleation rate, growth rate. Now if I total transformation rate is it integration of nucleation growth rate, that is why you find it this kind of curves. So therefore, if I plot temperature versus this thing, they look like this. Now let us stop here. In the next class we are going to discuss in detail about this, which I will do, and I will talk about it, the TTT curves.